Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. Today we will continue with our project, where we were interfacing the dot matrix display with STM32. In the previous video we saw how to store the data in the column form, and how to convert this data to the row form, so that we can send it to the display. We did it so that it would be easier for us to scroll the character or string on the display. Today we will write the functions to scroll characters and strings on the display. We will also use a font library later in the video. Let's continue with where we left the project in the previous video. Here you can see the same project with all the functions, which we created in the previous video. Let's create a new function to shift the display to the left. To do that we need to copy the continent of the current column to the adjacent column to the left, but this copying needs to start from the last column. Here we are copying the content of the current column to one column higher in the sequence. If the count value is 31, the data from column 31 will be copied into column 32, which does not exist. Therefore we will start our loop from column 30, so that we can store the data into column 31. Basically this is our column 0, and this is column 31. We want to shift the data from column 0 to column 31. But we need to start the process from the higher column first, therefore the data from column 30 will be copied into 31 first. Then the data from column 29 will be copied into 30, then 28 will copy into 29, and so on. Finally, call the function flush buffer to flush the entire column buffer to the display. When the count value will be 0, the content of column 0 will be copied into column 1. But the data in column 0 will still remain unchanged. So here we can either set this column to 0. Or you can update this column with the data from column 31, this will keep the entire display in the circular scrolling. Let's test if this shifting is working fine. We already have the data for the number 3 in the column buffer. Let's put it to the extreme right of the display. Now call the function shift left inside the while loop, and give some delay. This will keep shifting the character every 250 milliseconds. Alright, let's build and flash the project to the board. You can see the number 3 is shifting perfectly on the display. So the shifting is working fine without any issue. Let's see the fonts now. Here I have a font library, which is the closest I found for my display. This is extracted from the Arduino library. Let's copy this font file into our project. This file contains the data for every possible character, but I can't use this file as it is. Let's see an example for the number 1. We have the data bytes 40, 42, 7F, 7F, etc. Let's try to generate the character for this particular sequence. The first column is 40 hex, then the second column is 42 hex. Next is 7F, again 7F, then 40 hex and 40 hex. This is what we will see on the display if the data for the number 1 is passed to it. You can see the data generated here is the same as what we have for the number 1 in the font file. The number is inverted, and this is not how we want to see it. Let's design the same number in the proper format. You can see the data generated, and this is not the same of course. But if I change the endianness, we will get exactly the same data that we have in the font file. So this means that the fonts are fine, and we just need to change the endianness of each byte. This is not as simple as it sounds. Basically in the little endian format, the data byte is arranged such that the least significant bit is on the top. But in the big endian format, the most significant bit is on the top. So we will use these fonts. But we need to change the bit order before storing the data byte to the column buffer. Let's define a new function to shift the character on the display. The parameters of this function will be the character itself, and the delay between each shift. Here we will print the data to the first column of the display, and then shift the data to the left. We will repeat this process for the entire font width. This is to make sure that the entire font has been printed on the display. I have defined the font width in the font file. All the fonts defined in this file use 8 columns, therefore the font width is defined as 8. Inside this for loop, we need to change the order of the bits for each byte. First of all, we need to get the data array for the particular character from the font's database. The database is defined in a way that the row number points to the data for the particular character. We will start extracting from the first byte. We will take the 7th bit of the first byte. If this bit is a 1, we will write a 1 to the 0th bit of the data byte. If the bit is a 0, this condition will not run, and a 0 will be stored at the corresponding position. After the loop runs one more time, the j value will become 6. Now we will check the 6th bit of the first byte. If the bit is a 1, we will write a 1 to the first bit of the data byte. This loop will run for a total of 8 times, hence all the bits will be rearranged. After the first data byte has been extracted, we will store it in the 0th element of the column buffer. Now call the function flushBuffer to display the result on the device. Then the shiftLeft function will shift the entire display content to the left, and hence this data will now move to column 1. The index variable will increment, and we will now extract the second byte from the array, and store it again in the 0th element of the column buffer. This loop runs for the entire font width, so we will see the complete character on the display. The delay function controls how fast you want to display the respective character. Let's test if the function works fine. Let me delete these statements first. Now call the function shiftCharacter, and we will display the character C on the device. Let's build the project. I forgot to include the font's header file here. Alright, let's build and flash it to the board now. You can see the character C shifted to the left, and now it's fully printed on the display. Let's put this in the while loop, and see if it can be printed continuously. You can see a continuous stream of character C is being printed on the display. So this is actually how we scroll the string on the display. Let's define a new function to scroll the string. The parameter of this function will be the pointer to the string that we want to scroll. Inside this function, we will simply call the function to scroll the character, and pass the string pointer to it. Let's also add the delay parameter to the function. Let's test this function now. Call the function scrollString to scroll hello world. Note that I am calling it outside the while loop, so it will not scroll continuously. You can see the string hello world is scrolling on the display. The scrolling stopped once all the characters had been loaded on the display. Let's modify the delay to 100 milliseconds, and add one more space to the string. You can see the scrolling is faster now. Also, the string stopped a little more left compared to before, this is because we added one more space to it. If you want the continuous scrolling, you can add it to the while loop. Let's see the results now. The string is now scrolling continuously, and our project works fine so far. Now let's say that instead of scrolling the string, we simply want to print it on the display. Let's define a new function to print the string on the display. We will modify the code from the shiftCharacter function. Here we do not need the delay function, so remove it. Remove the shifting function also. This particular code only prints a single character, so let's put it inside another loop, which will cover all the columns. Let's remove this flush buffer from here, and put it outside the loop, so that the flushing will take place after all the columns have been populated. Note that we need to copy the data from the higher column first, this will arrange the string from left to right. The first column we will extract from the font data, we will copy it to the last element of the column buffer. Then the k value will decrease, and the next data byte will be stored in the second column from the end. This code was written to print a single character on the display, but here we have the entire string. So we need to change this parameter. Let's define a variable to store the string index. Instead of this character variable, we will pass the string data. The string index will point to a single character inside the string, and this entire loop will extract the character from the font data. So we will increment the string index outside this loop. Let's test this function now. Here we will print the string, hello. Let me typecast this string. Alright, let's build and flash the project to the board. You can see the string hello is printed, but the display can't accumulate the entire string. Let me try 1, 2, 3, 4. This number prints very well on the display. We can also use it to display the time. Again, some portion of the data is lying outside the display. Well, this is because I am using the wider fonts here. You can change the fonts to use a smaller width by modifying the file. Or create a new set of fonts for your project, which are comparatively smaller in width. So this is it for the video. We were able to scroll characters and string on the display. We also saw how to print the string on the display. This completes the series for the dot matrix display. You can download the project from the link in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.